renews itself as it changes though. Its silvery to sultry fire. The world I knit is heart and will. Delight untortured by my life. Through thee the gracious muses turn to furies of my enemy. And all the things of beauty burn with flames of evil ecstasy. Because of thee the land of dreams becomes a gathering place of fears, until tormented slumber seems one vehemence of useless tears. When sunlight glows upon the flowers or ripples down the dancing sea, thou with thy troop of passionate powers beleaguerest, bewilderest me.
Hi, everyone. Hi, I'm. Thanks for coming out tonight. I am Dr. Nathan Wallach, and this is a concert that's been put together by my students. This is actually, they've been working on this music all semester long. This is actually their final project, is putting together this concert. So we'll see how they do and if they pass their final exam tonight, this evening. Thank you guys for coming. Part of their assignment was to actually get people here. So good, they fulfilled that, and we filled these seats. The other thing that we've been, that I know some of you that are Stetson students are concerned about and interested in, this is a cultural credit event. Yes, thank you very much. Cultural credit will be given at the end of the show, so make sure that you see us at the end to get your card scanned. Hopefully you bought your IDs. You need your ID in order to get it scanned in order to get your cultural credit. Okay. Want to let people know that we are going to be continuing through the program with minimal breaks. So this is going to be one of just two speaking portions of the show where I just kind of introduce things and how things are going to go. I'll jump in right before the last one just to kind of sum everything up before we go. We're going to move with minimal breaks in between the different sets. That doesn't mean you can't applaud for the music if you like it, okay? Even if there isn't somebody on stage, somebody in this room actually put that music together and present it is for your presentation here tonight, so feel free to applaud for folks. There is coffee being provided by Collective, by Trilogy. There is decaf too, yes. So I know it's late at night for some of you for caffeine, so there is decaf available. Feel free to do that. There's also space to sit. There's space to move. Some of it is going to be of the dance type of variety of electronic music. And if the spirit is willing and you want to move, there's room up here in the front to do that. We don't want to stop people from doing that. Also, if you are taking pictures, sharing on social media, please feel free to do that. But we do ask that you tag us just so we can kind of see what kind of traction we're getting, what kind of support we're getting. All of our usernames are DIGAhertz. So just if you forget it, look up at the slide when you see the green text, okay? That's the username on Twitter, on Instagram, on whatever social platform of your choice it is, okay? So I'd appreciate you doing that. I think we'll move on to the next piece. If you're wanting to follow along, there are little pieces of paper on the various tables around the room for you to follow along with the names of the pieces, the person responsible, and a little bit of a brief description about it, okay? So do use your programs that are in front of you to kind of track along, and you can see what's coming next, what's coming up. But I'll go ahead and hand it off to our second piece, which is going to be Victoria Grupp's sonification here. Thank you.
consider a curve as just a curve. But it seems I've been laboring under false pretenses. Because a curve is most certainly not just a curve. Itself. The curve is a product of the love that bears it.
that.
Dagon by H.P. Lovecraft. I am writing this under an appreciable mental strain. Since by tonight, I shall be no more. Penniless, and at the end of my supply of drugs, which alone makes life endurable, I can bear the torture no longer. I shall cast myself from this garret window into the squalid street below. Do not think from my slavery to morphine that I am a weakling or a degenerate. When you have read these hastily scrawled pages, you may guess, though never fully realize, why it is that I must have forgetfulness or death.
It was in one of the most open and least frequented parts of the broad Pacific that the packet of which I was supercargo fell victim to the German sea raider. The Great War was then at its very beginning, and the ocean forces of the Hun had not completely sunk to their later degradation, so that our vessel was made a legitimate prize, whilst we of her crew were treated with all the fairness and consideration due to us as naval prisoners. So liberal indeed that was the discipline of our captors that 5 days after we were taken, I managed to escape alone on a small boat with water and provisions for a good length of time. When I finally found myself adrift and free, I had little idea of my surroundings. Never a competent navigator, I could only guess vaguely by the sun and stars that I was somewhat south of the equator. Of the longitude, I knew nothing, and no island or coastline was in sight. The weather kept fair, and for uncounted days I drifted aimlessly beneath the scorching sun, waiting either for some passing ship or to be cast to the shores of some habitable land. But neither ship nor land appeared, and I began to despair in my solitude upon the heaving vastness of unbroken blue.
Table.
The change happened whilst I slept. Its detail I shall never know, for my slumber, though troubled and dream-infested, was continuous. When at last I awaked, it was to discover myself half-sucked into a slimy expanse of hellish black mire which extended about me in monotonous undulations as far as I could see, and in which my boat lay grounded some distance away. Though one might well imagine that my first sensation would be of wonder at so prodigious and unexpected a transformation of scenery, I was in reality more horrified than astonished, for there was in the air and in the rotting soil a sinister quality which chilled me to the core.
The region was putrid with the carcasses of decaying fish and of other less describable things, which I saw protruding from the nasty mud of the unending plain. Perhaps I should not hope to convey in mere words the unutterable hideousness of what dwell in absolute silence and barren immensity. There was nothing within hearing and nothing in sight save a vast reach of black slime, and yet the very completeness of the stillness and homogeneity of the landscape oppressed me with nauseating fear. The sun was blazing down from a sky which seemed to me almost black in its cloudless cruelty, as though reflecting the inky marsh between my feet. As I crawled onto the stranded boat, I realized that only one theory could explain my position. Through some unprecedented volcanic upheaval, a portion of the ocean floor must have thrown to the surface, exposing regions which for innumerable millions of years lain hidden under unfathomable watery depths. So great was the extent of the new land which had risen beneath me that I could not detect the faintest noise of the surging ocean, strain my ears as I might. Nor were there any sea fowl to prey upon the dead things. For several hours, I sat thinking or brooding in the boat, which lay upon its side and afforded slight shade as the sun moved across the heavens. As the day progressed, the ground lost some of its stickiness and seemed to dry sufficiently for traveling purposes in a short time.
That night I slept but little. And the next day I made for myself a pack containing food and water, preparing for an overland journey in search of the vanished sea, impossible rescue.
On the third morning, I found the soil dry enough to walk upon with ease. The odor of the fish was maddening, but I was too much concerned with graver things to mind so slight an evil, and set out boldly for an unknown goal.
Okay.
day I forged steadily westward, guided by a faraway hummock which rose higher than any other elevation in the rolling desert. That night I encamped, and on the following day still traveled toward the hummock, though that object seemed scarcely nearer than when I had first espied it. By the fourth evening, I attained the base of the mound, which turned out to be much higher than it appeared from a distance. An intervening valley set it out in sharper relief from the general surface. Too weary to ascend, I slept in the shadow of the hill.
I know not why my dreams were so wild that night, but ere the waning and fantastically gibbous moon had risen far above the eastern plain, I was awake in a cold perspiration, determined to sleep no more. Such visions as I had experienced were too much for me to endure again, and in the glow of the moon I saw how unwise I had been to travel by day. Without the glare and the parching sun, my journey would have cost me less energy. Indeed, I now felt quite able to perform the ascent which had deterred me at sunset. Picking up my pack, I started for the crest of the eminence.
I have said that the unbroken monotony of the rolling plain was the source of vague horror to me. But I think my horror was greater when I gained the summit of the mound and looked down on the other side to an unmeasurable pit or canyon whose black recesses the moon had not yet soared high enough to illumine. I felt myself on the edge of the world, peering over into a rim of a fathomless chaos of eternal night. Through my terror ran curious reminiscences of Paradise Lost and of Satan's hideous climb through the unfathomed realms of darkness. As the moon climbed higher into the sky, I began to see that the slopes of the valley were not quite so perpendicular as I had imagined. Ledges and outcroppings of rock afforded fairly easy footholds for a descent, whilst after a drop of a few hundred feet, the declivity below became very gradual. Urged on by an impulse which I cannot definitely analyze, scrambled with difficulty through the rocks and stood on the gentler slope beneath, gazing into the Stygian depths where no light had yet penetrated.
Once my attention was captured by a vast and singular object on the opposite slope, which rose steeply about 100 yards ahead of me. An object that gleamed whitely in the newly bestowed rays of the ascending moon. That it was merely a gigantic piece of stone, I soon assured myself, but I was conscious of a distinct impression that its contour and position were not altogether the work of nature. A closer scrutiny filled me with sensations as I cannot express, for despite its enormous magnitude and its position in an abyss which had yawned at the bottom of the sea since the world was young,
I doubt that the strange object was a well-shaped monolith whose massive bulk had known the workmanship, and perhaps the worship, of living and thinking creatures. Dazed and frightened, yet not without a certain thrill of the scientist or archaeologist's delight, I examined my surroundings more closely. The moon, now near the zenith, shone weirdly and vividly above the towering steeps that hemmed in the chasm, and revealed the fact that a far-flung body of water at the bottom, winding out of sight in both directions, almost lapped at my feet as I stood on the slope. Across the chasm, the wavelets washed the base of the cyclopean monolith, on whose surface I could now trace the inscriptions and crude sculptures.
The writing was in a system of hieroglyphics unknown to me, and unlike anything I had ever seen in books. Consisting for the most part of conventionalized aquatic symbols such as fishes, eels, octopi, crustaceans, mollusks, whales, and the like, several characters obviously represented marine things which are unknown to the modern world, but whose decomposing forms I had observed in the ocean risen plain.
It was the pictorial carving, however, that did the most to hold me spellbound. Plainly visible across the intervening water on account of their enormous size were an array of bas reliefs whose subjects would have excited the envy of a Doré. these things were supposed to depict men, at least a certain sort of men, though the creatures were shown disporting like fishes in the waters of some marine grotto, or paying homage at some monolithic shrine which appeared to be under the waves as well. Of their faces and forms, I dare not speak in detail, for they were a remembrance makes me grow faint. Grotesque beyond the imagination of whole.
Grotesque beyond the imagination of whole or lower. Damnably human in general outline, despite webbed hands and feet. Shockingly wide and glassy, bulging eyes and other features less pleasant to
Curiously enough, they seem to have been chiseled back.
Of killing a whale, represented as but a little larger than himself. I remarked, as I say, their grotesqueness and strange size, but in a moment decided that they were merely the imaginary gods of some primitive fishing or seafaring tribe. Some tribe whose last descendant had perished eras before the first ancestor of the Piltdown or Neanderthal man was born. Awestruck. Glimpse of the past beyond the conception of the most daring anthropologist, I stood, musing, whilst the moon cast clear reflections on the silent channel before me. It darted like a stupendous monster of nightmares to the monolith, about which it flung its gigantic, scaly arms, the while it bestowed its hideous head and gave vent to certain measured sounds. I think I went mad then. Of my frantic ascent to the slope and cliff, of my delirious journey back to the stranded boat, I remember little. I believe I sang a great deal and laughed oddly when I was unable to sing. I have indistinct recollections of a great storm sometime after I reached the boat. At any rate, I know that I heard peals of thunder and other tones which nature utters in her wildest moods.
When I came out of the shadows, I was in a San Francisco hospital, brought there by the captain of the American ship which had picked up my boat in mid-ocean. In my delirium, I had said much, but found that my words had been given scant attention. Of any land upheaval in the Pacific, my rescuers knew nothing, nor did I deem it necessary to insist upon a thing which I knew they could not believe.
Once I sought out a celebrated ethnologist and amused him with peculiar questions regarding the ancient Philistine legend.
Dagon, the fish god. But soon perceiving that he was hopelessly conventional, I did not press my inquiries.
It's night, especially when the moon is gibbous and waning, that I see the thing. I tried morphine, but the drug has only given transient surcease and has drawn me into its clutches as a hopeless slave. So now I am to end it all, having written a full account for the information or the contemptuous amusement of my fellow men. Often, I ask myself, it could not have been a pure phantasm, a mere freak of fever as I lay sun-stricken and raving in the open boat after my escape from the German man of war. This I ask myself, but ever does there come before me a hideous vision in reply. I cannot think of the deep sea without shuddering at the nameless things that may at this very moment be crawling and floundering on its slimy bed, worshipping their ancient stone idols and carving their own detestable likenesses on submarine obelisks of water-soaked granite. I dream of a day when they may rise above the billows to drag down in their reeking towns the remnants of puny, war-exhausted mankind. Of a day when the land shall sink and the dark ocean floor shall ascend amidst universal pandemonium.
Hear a noise at the door.
hands.
Lunging against it.
The hand.
It shall not find me. God! That hand! The window! The window!
I'm
Thanks, everybody, for coming out tonight. Really appreciate you guys coming down here. want to just thank you, give a few thanks to folks that helped make this night possible. One, first and foremost, to Collective for letting us use their venue here. This is a pretty nice venue for having concerts, so I'm hoping that we can just think about making a habit of this, so it would be nice. Also, thanks to Stetson for letting us have the last cultural credit event on study day. So that was nice of them to let us do that. So good luck to all of you that have finals coming up over the next few days. Hopefully it was nice to get a little bit of a break, get some caffeine in you before you pull an all-nighter before that tomorrow exam, yes. And then the really important thing that I know a lot of you are concerned with, the cultural credit scanner, okay? Anthony, go ahead and raise your hand. Everybody see Anthony? Anthony is the one that will have the scanner after this final set. You need to see him with your IDs, and he will scan you to make sure you get cultural credit for this event. And then I think that brings us to our last slot, which are two of our seniors. We've got quite a few seniors tonight. This is actually their last performance at Stetson as part of as a Stetson Hatters. So they're going on to bigger and better things after this, hopefully, yes. Finally, well, who knows, right? Yeah. I want to hand it over here to Casey and Tony, who will be taking us out with the last set of the evening. Thanks very much for coming.